Good evening. 晚安。
大家晚上好。
So tonight I'm going to talk a little bit about the Platform Sutra of the Sixth Patriarch Wei Nung from China.
今天我会给大家稍微讲一下有关六祖坛经里面的一些教导。
How many people here have actually read it?
有谁读过六祖坛经？请举手。
You know, if you ever teach school, you always go into class, and then you say, well, how many people did their homework? And of course, nobody raises their hand. Well, they all raised their hand, but they didn't actually do it.
如果你去学校上课开始的时候，你通常会问学生，啊，你们有多少人做过了功课？可能只有一两位举手，或者大家都举手，但事实上他们并没有做功课。Yes.
He's a university professor, so he knows what I'm talking about. So that means, actually, I have to start from scratch.
所以呢，禅师说他要从头开始。
So you can actually get a copy of this sutra for free.
这个六祖坛经中英，我们这边有英文翻译，然后也有中文本，这是免费的结缘品。
But traditionally, Buddhist literature is free. You don't have to pay for it, right?
那当然，传统从以前一直到现在，佛陀的教导都是免费的，你并不需要花钱去买。
So when I was going to translate this, I think it started about 10 years ago, right after Zen Master Sung Sung's death. We had to decide what kind of text are we going to translate from.
那大概在十年前，就是崇山禅师刚圆寂的时候，禅师就开始这个翻译的工作。那时他们在想说，要用怎么样的方式来表达，是要用现代式呢，还是过去式？
So Daquan's name in Hong Kong, who helped me translate this because I don't speak Chinese, said, oh, I have an idea. She ran over to the shopping mall, went to a little Buddhist stall, picked up a free copy of it, and ran back and said, yeah, we'll use this one.
那时香港大观禅师他就帮我做这个翻译。那他那时他想说，哦，我有一个想法，他就到了那个一间书店，然后就捡起了一本六祖坛经，然后带回来说，我们就采用这本。
So that's interesting because this isn't something that was dug up from the ground. You know, it's not a terma like in Tibetan Buddhism, and it wasn't found in some cave by some British explorer. You know, about 200 years ago, it's just something you can pick up at the mall.
这是很有趣的，因为这个六祖坛经并不需要你从泥土里面挖出来，或者从铁塔上面找到，也不用去很深山里面去找，你只要到书店里面或者超市里面可能就找得到了。
But actually, that's good because accessibility is the most important thing. So it's free, right? Anybody can get it. Anybody can read it.
但是这很重要，因为我们可以很容易的就获得六祖坛经，那大家都可以去读，大家都可以去了解。
So actually, that comes from Zen because there's nothing secret going on in Zen. There's no hidden secret.
那禅宗其实也是这样子，在禅宗里面并没有什么神秘的东西隐藏在文字背后。
So I'm not going to hide anything from you.
所以我并没有想要隐藏什么东西。
And definitely, the Buddha didn't hide anything from you.
那当然，佛陀也没有对大家隐藏任何的东西。
Actually, sometimes I wish, wow, if only they'd hide something, it wouldn't be so scary.
有时候会想说，如果佛陀隐藏了什么的话，那可能没有那么的恐怖。
So, this sutra is one of the sutras that is attributed to somebody other than the Buddha. So it's attributed to this Chinese man.
那这一本六祖坛经，它称为经，就是佛经。这是所有佛经以外唯一一个以一个中国人的名字命名的经。
And it forms the basis of modern Zen teaching style.
那这个六祖坛经它是现代禅宗教导方式的基础。
So if you read books by my teacher or any Zen teacher, ultimately they're going to find their roots in this sutra.
所以如果你们读崇山禅师的教导或任何其他禅师的教导，你会发现这些教导的基础都是来自六祖坛经。
So Zen style was brought to China by Bodhidharma in the early part of the 6th century, early 500s. But then over the years, it slowly became, well, we would say academically, we'd say Sinophied. It became Chinese-like.
菩提达摩他在六世纪的时候把禅宗的教导从印度带到了中国，然后在往后的日子里面，他就慢慢的就变成中国化。
So my teacher always said that Mahayana Buddhism came to China, then it met Taoism, and then they had a baby, and that baby was Zen.
我的老师常说呢，印度的大乘佛法，然后来到了中国，然后遇见了中国的道教或者道家，然后他们就生了一个孩子，这个孩子呢就是禅宗。
So one very simple way to think about this is that Mahayana Buddhism introduced compassion, love and compassion into Taoism.
那一个很简单的了解的方法呢，就是大乘佛法把慈悲灌进了那个道教的教导里面去。
And the way that most Western people, the country where I come from, the United States, the way most Western people understand Buddhism and Zen is through Chinese sources.
很多西方人，包括我在内呢，都是通过中国的一些文献去了解佛经或者佛教的教导。
Which is kind of ironic because the Buddha definitely spoke an Indo-European language, right?
这是很有趣的，因为佛陀他本身呢讲的当然是印度语。
And then all of these texts are brought to China.
那这些佛经呢被带到了中国。
And they get translated into Chinese. That's a big jump from Sanskrit or Pali into Chinese.
那这些佛经经由一些高僧从梵文还有巴利文翻译成中文。
And then in the United States, what we do is we read English translations of the Chinese text.
在美国和欧洲呢，我们读的是中文翻译的英文翻译。
So that's kind of interesting.
这是很有趣的。
So one way to think about this platform sutra is that it's a commentary on the Diamond Sutra.
那了解六祖坛经的一个方法呢，就是把它当成是对金刚经的注解。
So all the themes, all the kind of story, the thread of the story of the six patriarchs' life, all that stuff comes from the Diamond. Is a commentary on the Diamond Sutra.
所以六祖他的经历以及他的教导呢，基本上就是对于金刚经的注解。
So a lot of people have trouble with philosophical or conceptual Buddhism.
很多人对于概念化的佛教呢不太了解。
And particularly if you're teaching children, you can't talk about that.
特别是如果你去教导小孩子的话，你没办法跟他讲概念化或者哲学化的东西。
So how do you teach it? Well, you teach it through stories.
那你要怎么教导小朋友呢？方法就是用故事讲故事的方法。
So you'll notice if you practice Zen, you encounter all these Zen stories.
所以如果你修禅的话，你就会听到很多禅宗的故事。
And the reason they use stories, just like you do with children, is because it goes into your consciousness and it kind of goes over the barrier of your discriminating consciousness or your checking mind, and it goes directly in. Right.
那就像小朋友一样，这个故事会绕过我们的分别心，然后直接进到我们的意识里面。
So you may not understand much about Buddhist philosophy, but you do know the story, you know, the narrative of the Buddha's life, right?
很多人可能并不太了解佛教的一些理论，但是呢，对于佛教的故事却是很容易了解的。
Actually, it's much more important than any intellectual looking into Buddhist philosophy.
事实上，这些故事对我们的帮助比你去想要很深入的了解佛教的一些哲理化或者理论的东西更重要。
That's because the stories hit you in your guts, you know, not in your brain.
因为这些故事直接就进入到我们的心里面，我们的骨子里面，而不是在意识层面上漂浮。
So the Buddha was a pretty smart guy, right?
佛陀他是很聪明的一位。
But the story of his life is really, really interesting.
那有关于他的生命的故事呢，非常的有趣。
In fact, the themes of the narrative of his life are the most important part of Buddhism.
事实上，佛陀他一生的这个故事呢，是佛教里面最重要的一个部分。
And anybody can understand them.
每一个人都能够了解。
You know, so he's born into a very wealthy family.
他出生在一个很富有的家庭。
And his father runs a small little kingdom.
他的父亲是一个小国的国王。
And he's next in line.
那他是王位的继承者。
To take over.
要继承王位。
You know, it's like you're born into a really nice rich family here in Singapore.
就像你可能在新加坡，你生在一个非常富有的家庭。
But then a very dramatic thing happens to him, even though he's raised in this kind of like a bubble. You know, it's like he lived in some condo over here off of Orchard Road or something. He comes down over here to Geelong and he sees all kinds of stuff. And it really shocks him.
佛陀当时呢，他居住的地方就像比如说我们乌节路的一个。高级住宅里面的一栋，然后他离开了那个家，然后就跑到了芽龙这边来，然后就发现啊，很多很吃惊的东西。
So the description of his experience is that he encounters an old person, a sick person, and a dead corpse laying beside the road. Then he has a very strong experience, as we do.
那这故事说呢，六祖他就看到了一个老人、一个病人，还有一个死人。那这对于他来讲产生一个很强的冲击。那我们每一个人也会这样子。
So we all share this, you know, an old person. Well, you can just look at me, then you get the idea.
所以我们大家都会经历同样的过程。比如说老人，那我就是其中一位。
But even if you're young, you experience sickness, right?
那即使你是很年轻，你还是会有经验过生病。
Or people around you are sick.
或者你周围的人生病
，and then dead，
然后死亡。
In the West, we always say you don't really understand that you yourself are going to die until your parents die. Then, you know, it's unavoidable.
那在西方呢，有个谚语说，我们不知道我们终会死亡，一直到我们发现我们的父母死亡的时候。
So what happens is.He lives in this bubble, and he comes out of the bubble, and he sees an old person, a sick person, and a dead corpse. Then this really affects his mind.
佛陀呢，他离开皇宫，然后他就看到一个老人、一个病人，还有一个死人的时候呢，他心里面产生了很大的困扰。
I remember when I was a young man, I never liked to go to the hospital.Because there were sick people there, so I didn't even like to visit people I should be visiting. Although I did do it, but I didn't like it at all.
那禅师说他年轻的时候呢，他不太喜欢去医院拜访。虽然说他应该去，但是他很不喜欢去，因为那边很多病人。
So behind these three things is things are always changing, right?
那这老人。病人跟死人所代表的含义就是所有的一切都不断的在变化。
So sickness makes things change. Getting older definitely makes things change. And of course, death is just a clumsy word for change.
那生病的意思就是有一些东西在变化。 我们变老也是有一些东西在变化，那死亡也就是一些东西在变化的一个代名词。
So the Buddha gets this big question. Well, if there's these three things, and we share these three things, actually we were just like the Buddha. If there's these three things, then what are we here for? Why are we born?
那当时佛陀呢，他心里面就升起一个很大的疑惑：如果我们有老病死，那每个人都有。
So we called.
为什么我们会生出来呢？
So we call this the great question of life and death.
我们说它是生死的大问题。
Why are we here?
我们为什么会来到世间？
Because the usual things you think about why we're here, you know, to get a good education, marry a nice man or woman, get a nice house, have a nice car, maybe join a country club, get a credit card. All of those, the five C's,soon to go away, and you don't know when.
那很多人他们会认为我们来到世间呢，就是要过好的生活，有好的工作，讨到好的老婆，或者嫁一个好的丈夫，或者能够住进一栋洋房，然后有信用卡，有五 C。但是我们不知道这五 C 什么时候会忽然间就不见掉了。
So no matter what you do, those three things are going to eat you.
那不管你做什么，这老病死这三种东西就会不断的吃掉你。
So then the Buddha couldn't answer this question.
啊，佛陀当时没办法回答这个最重大的问题。
Then he did something very interesting. He left and went and started looking inside, we say practicing meditation, right? Look inside, look inside, look inside. He didn't move to a library. He moved to a tree.
那佛陀当时就做了一个决定，他离开了皇宫，然后他坐在菩提树下，往内心去关照，问自己我到底是什么。他并没有去图书馆。
Then one morning he sees a star and his mind opens. He knows the answer.
那有一天晚上清晨他看见一颗星星，他的心打开了，然后他就发现了答案。
And the answer is very interesting.
那这个答案非常的有趣。
But hearing about it doesn't really answer the question for you. That's the interesting thing.
那更有趣的是，你听了这个答案之后，并不会为你的内心开解，不能够开解你的内心。
So what he said is that human beings suffer because they don't really understand what they are.
他说人之所以会受苦是因为他们不知道他们本来是什么。
So most human beings think I'm going to get something and then I'll be happy. Right? Everybody thinks that.
因为每个人都认为如果我能够获得所有的我需要的东西我就会很快乐。
My teacher always said everybody wants a good situation.But nobody can keep it.
那我的老师常说，每一个人都想要获得一些好的处境，但是没有人能够保有它。
So that's the Buddha's experience, just shrunk down into one sentence. Everybody wants a good experience, but nobody, a good situation, but nobody can keep it.
那佛陀他这所有的经验呢，都浓缩成一句话，就是每个人都想要获得一些好的处境，但是没有人能够保有它。
So that's our misunderstanding is we're going to be happy because we can get something.
所以我们认为获得一些东西之后就会快乐，这是错误的理解。
Then here's something really radical. What he taught was that we already have it, we just don't know it.
那很根本的发现呢，就是佛陀说我们其实已经拥有了，只是我们不了解。
And the answer lives right inside of us if we just take a look.
如果我们往内心去关照的话，你就会发现原来答案已经在你心里面。
And he called that inside thing, Buddha nature.
他把这个内心的东西称为佛性。
So everybody, the person you hate the most, the person you love the most evil person ever in history, or Jesus or Buddha, they all have this.
那每一个人都有佛性。 即使是你最讨厌的人，或者是你最喜欢的人，或者是最邪恶的人，或者是圣人，像基督或者佛陀，每一个人都已经有了。
So, the sixth patriarch calls it original nature, true nature. I translated with the term true nature. There's about four or five different terms he uses during the sutra, but I just use one to make it simple. They all mean true nature, which means Buddha nature.
那六祖称它为自性。那在六祖坛经里面有几个不同的名字，那禅师他在翻译的时候就统称为自性。
So the answer to the big question is to find out what you truly are.
所以这个问题的答案呢，就是去了解你的自性到底是什么。
So the Buddha is a very high-class person.
佛陀是一个非常高级的人。
He's very rich.
他非常有钱。
He's a monk.
他是出家人。
He's well-educated.
他受过很好的教育。
He has the prospect of a very good job in the future.
他的这个生涯，职业生涯非常的好。
He's very handsome. He's a desirable person.
他很英俊，他是众人喜爱的人。
Now the problem is when you hear that story, you start to associate what he did with what his personal narrative is.
但是当你听到这个的时候，你可能会把他一生的事迹跟这些不同的描述挂钩。
Then if we jump ahead about 1,000 years, we come to the sixth patriarch.
然后你就横越时空一千年，然后我们就遇到了六祖。
So he also gets a big enlightenment. It's so big we still remember it now.
六祖也证得一个很大的开悟。
But his personal narrative is just the opposite.
但是六祖有关六祖的描述刚好是佛陀跟佛陀的刚好相反。
And my theory is that the reason the narrative is different is because the difference emphasizes that true nature isn't based on any of these circumstances.
那我的理论就是六祖的他的有关他的描述跟佛陀的描述刚好相反，原因是因为自信跟这些东西没有关联。
So when he gets enlightenment, he's a very young person, about the same age as the Buddha.
当六祖证得开悟的时候，他还很年轻，大概跟佛陀当时的年龄差不多。
But he's very poor. He's a woodcutter.
但是六祖非常的贫穷，他是一位樵夫。
How many woodcutters are in here?In here, any? Are there any woodcutters? Anybody make their money cutting wood?
这里有没有樵夫
？Well, we don't use wood anymore.
当然，我们不再去砍柴来烧。
And because he's a woodcutter, of course, he's not rich. He's not like the Buddha.
那因为六祖他是樵夫，所以他很贫穷，不像佛陀那么有钱。
So Buddha had a very high-class job. He's a kind of prince, and actually, he's more like a burger. Can you say burger in Chinese?
Burger.
Yeah, he's a, it's kind of, what would you say, a government official who is, he's not it's not a hereditary thing. It's because it's a group of people who run a city state. Probably not much different than the members of parliament here.
那佛陀他当时还在家的时候，他的职位就相当于我们新加坡的国会议员，是他能够继承一个很高的位置。
Actually, the Buddha is a lot like Yi Xianglong.
佛陀当时的他的位置就很像我们的李显龙总理。
Right, he's the son of.
他是某某名人的儿子。
But the sixth patriarch isn't that at all. He's the lowest of the low.
六祖刚好就相反，他是最低阶最低阶的人。
So he's not high class. He's also poor.
六祖他是低阶层的人，而且很贫穷。
And he doesn't read.
而且他不认识字。
Right? He's illiterate.
他没有读过书，不认识字。
Also, he's a layman.
而且他是在家居士。
So he also hasn't been around very long. He's, you know, he's not an established scholar of Buddhism or anything. He's a, just a, in English we'd say he's a country bumpkin from Texas, maybe.
那六祖呢，他当然他没有受过教育，他我们说他是一个怎么讲，就是乡巴佬这样子，对。
Then one day he's walking. He lives in on the outskirts of Guangzhou in Guangdong Province in mainland China.
那有一天他在广州那边，他砍了柴，然后到广州市去卖。
Then one day he's walking through the marketplace to one of his customers to sell some firewood. He sells the firewood and then he leaves.
那他有一天呢，他就拿一些柴要去广州市去卖给他的他的顾客。
Now these days you don't see monks in Hong Kong standing on the corner chanting because it's illegal. But in those days, you could see a monk, you know, standing on the corner chanting.
那在现在，如果在香港或者在新加坡，你不会看到有一个出家人在市集里面诵经，因为那是不合法的。但是在当时的中国呢，广州就会有这样的出家人在那边诵经。
So he passes by this monk, and this monk is chanting the Diamond Sutra. This is important, the Diamond Sutra.
那当时这个僧人他在诵《金刚经》啊，这非常重要。然后六祖就经过。
And just as he walks by, the monk chants the line, "When thinking arises in your mind, don't attach to it."
那当六祖经过的时候，他听到这个僧人在诵《金刚经》，然后诵到“因无所住而生其心
”，then boom。
然后就 boom.
Translation.
Thank you.
Then he gets enlightenment.
然后他就证得开悟。
So sometimes I think, you know, every Friday night here we chant the Diamond Sutra, right?
在这里，我们每个礼拜五晚上都会诵《金刚经》。
So I keep thinking, you know, like somebody will get off the elevator here and walk by the door, and just then they're chanting some line, and they'll go, oh.
然后我就在想说，会不会有人在刚好从电梯出来经过，然后听到有人诵《金刚经》，然后就呼。
I don't know if that happened. I don't know.
有没有发生过这种事情
？That happens. Tell me. Okay.
如果有的话，告诉我一下。
So then, most of the money he makes, he uses to take care of his mother.
那六祖他砍柴去卖，然后来供养他的母亲。
So a person gives him some money to give to his mother so that she can live because he wants to go north and visit the teacher of this monk that was chanting on the street.
那六祖听到之后，那个诵经之后呢，他就筹到了一些钱，有人给他一些钱，让他可以去供养他的妈妈，让他妈妈可以独自生活，因为他要去找这个僧人的师父。
So he goes to the fifth patriarch's place, which is in northern China.
他就去到了中国北方五祖的寺院。
So when he gets there, the fifth he talks to the fifth patriarch, and the fifth patriarch says, "You know, you're not worth anything. You're just a barbarian from the south."
那他去到遇到五祖的时候，五祖就说：“你只不过是一个三八佬，你什么都不懂。”
So here's another characteristic. He's a barbarian. Not only is he lower class, uneducated, terrible job, but he's also a barbarian.
所以六祖他又多了一个名称，他不只是低级的人、穷人，然后而且。没有受过教育的人，而且他还是所谓的葛僚，就是粗人的意思。
But then he says to the fifth patriarch, "Yeah, it's true. People can be from the north or from the south, but Buddha nature is all the same." You know, then the fifth patriarch, "Oh, this person has got something."
然后六祖听到五祖那样说的时候，他就说。他就跟五祖说：“人虽然有南北的分别，但是佛性没有南北的分别。”然后五祖听到的时候就知道啊，这个人不简单。
So he doesn't spend 6 years like the Buddha practicing meditation. He just hears one line, then boom.
六祖并不像五祖那样花了六年的时间然后来静坐，他只是听到一句话，然后他就证得开悟。
So this comes from the Diamond Sutra.
这是从金刚经里面出来的。
So in the Diamond Sutra, the Buddha says there is no formula that guarantees that you will get enlightenment.
那佛陀他在金刚经里面说，并没有一个固定的法可以让你证得开悟。
So many times human beings get very attached to like meditation techniques and treat them as if some kind of formula is going to lead to some kind of result. Kind of like if you run every day, soon you'll be able to run a marathon or something.
那有很多人呢会把坐禅的一些方式当成是一个很特别的方程式，如果你去做的话呢，你就会获得一些东西。就好像说，如果你每天练习跑步的话，你可能有一天可以跑马拉松。
But the six patriarchs in this tradition called the Southern School or the Southern School of Zen.
那六祖他来自这个所谓的顿教法门。
So there's no formula that's going to lead to this waking up.
那没有一个既定的方程式可以让你证得开悟。
And his life is an example of that.
那他的生命，六祖的生命就是一个最好的例子。
Also in this, in this sutra, you see the first use of the, what today we call a koan.
那在六祖坛经里面，你可以读到我们现在称为公案的一些教导。
So after he's established as a teacher and the sixth patriarch, the guy that's going to become the seventh patriarch comes to visit him. His name is Huai Rong.
那当六祖他成为六祖然后开始教导的时候呢，有一位叫怀让的人的比丘就来参拜六祖，他就是之后的七祖。
So maybe it's kind of like a situation like this, the sixth patriarch is talking and then this monk comes in.
那就有点像现在这样子，六祖在开示然后就有人进来了。
So right away, the sixth patriarch is a pretty sharp character. He sees, oh, this is some kind of special person.
那六祖他当然的目光锐利，他一看到怀让就知道这个人不简单。
So he says to Huai Rong, "What is this thing you've brought here, and how did it come?"
那六祖就问他说：“你是什么东西来到这里？是怎么来的？”
Then Huai Rong says, "If you call it a thing, already you are mistaken." In other words, he hits back, right?
那怀让他说：“说是一物即不重，意思就是如果你说它是一样东西，那已经是错误了。”所以他马上反击。
So this is one of the first kind of like dialogues or back and forth that you could interpret as being like a what we today know as a koan.
那这种问答的方式呢，就形成一种形式，我们现在称为公案。
Also, right after he got a transmission from the fifth patriarch, He was chased by a bunch of high-level monks who were angry because he's a nobody and he gets transmission while all these quite substantial, upright, long-practicing monks didn't get transmission. So they're angry and they're trying to catch him and kill him.
那当时六祖他获得五祖传法之后呢，他就带了五祖传给他的衣钵跟袈裟，然后就逃离，然后有很多大法师，五祖门下大法师都来追逐他，因为他们很生气。六祖他是一个没有受过教育的在家居士，什么都不懂，但是竟然能够获得传法。这些高僧在那边已经很久了，但是却没有获得传法，他们很生气，他们要追六祖，然后把他杀掉。
So they're chasing him all around, and finally one of them.Hui Ming, who used to be a general in the Chinese army, catches up with him.
那他们追了很久，其中有一位叫惠明的出家人，他之前是一位将军，孔武有力，然后他就追上了六祖。
So one thing that this monk wants to do is get back the symbols of transmission, which in this case are a begging bowl and a special robe.
那慧能追上去了之后，他就要去抢回他的衣钵、的袈裟跟他的那个钵。
So when the sixth patriarch sees he's about to be caught, he hides behind a tree and just sets the robe and the bowl on a rock.
六祖发现了之后，他就把他的衣袈裟跟他的钵放在石头上，然后躲起来。
Then this former general monk tries to pick him up, but they're too heavy.
那这位将军他要去把袈裟举起来，但是太重了，他举不起来。
So they're not too heavy because they're too heavy. They're too heavy because of what they symbolize.
那当然，他举不起来，并不是他的重量很重，而是它代表的含义太重了，所以他不敢举起来。
So then the monk gets very scared because he can't pick up these two objects.
那慧明他举不起这个两样东西的时候呢，他就非常的害怕。
Then the sixth patriarch comes out from behind the tree.
然后六祖就从树背后出来了。
The monk says, "Oh, I didn't come from the robe of the bowl. I came from teaching from you, layman."
然后慧明看到他的时候，就跟他说：“哦，我来这里不是要来抢你的袈裟，我是想来跟你学习。”
Then the sixth patriarch says, "Make your mind clear."
然后六祖说：“让你的心空掉。”
So he waits for a second.
然后他等了一会儿。
We do that too when I ask you, "Kung and Yo."So that makes your mind clear. My mind too.
那我们在小餐的时候也有这样子。当你这个时候，你的心就空掉了。
Right.
那我也一样。
Then he says, "What's your original face? The face you had before your parents were born."
然后之后呢，六祖就问他，你的父母还没有出生之前的本来面目是什么
？Then when he hears that, Hui Ming gets enlightenment. Boom.
然后慧明他听到这个问题的时候，他也证得开悟。
Then the sixth patriarch said, "Well, what did you get?"
六祖问他说：“你证悟了什么
？”And then Wei Ming says something very interesting. He says, "It's just like water. When I taste it, I can tell for myself whether it's hot or it's cold."
慧明的回答很有趣，他说：“如人饮水，冷暖自知。”
So that means he had a direct experience, right?
意思就是说，他获得一个很直接的体验。
So this is a kong. In fact, we still use this kong on today.
这也是一个公案。事实上，我们现在还在用这个公案。
So this is an interesting kind of introduction of this style of teaching that appears in this platform sutra.
那这种非常有趣的教导的方式呢，就在《六祖坛经》里面有说到。
So another major theme of this sutra is that the meaning of the teachings is not contained in the words.
那六祖坛经的一个另外一个很重要的教导就是，禅宗或者佛教的含义并不在文字里面。
So it doesn't have anything to do with technique.
它跟你的方法没有关系。
And it doesn't have anything to do with your understanding.
它跟你的理解也没有关系。
I know when I first started practicing, I met my teacher. One of the first things he said to me was, "Stop reading books." That shocked me.
那我当我刚开始啊跟我的老师学习的时候，他跟我讲的第一句话就是不要再读书，然后我就吓到了，这什么意思
？So if you're a Buddhist, guaranteed you've read all the books you ever need to read in this lifetime or your five next lifetimes. Believe me.
如果你是佛教徒的话，相信我，你已经读够了书了，你不需要再读，这一世甚至下来五世都已经读够了。
So the reason is because all of this thinking about this stuff is actually a hindrance.
原因是我们的思维，我们的理解和思维对证得我们的自信其实是一种障碍。
Actually, it's kind of a paradox. The more you understand, the less you know.
其实它很吊诡的就是。你知道的越多，你了解的越少。
So, there are several instances in this sutra where he encounters monks and nuns who study sutras, and then he has some kind of interaction with them.
那六祖坛经里面有讲到说，六祖他遇到了一些僧人或者比丘尼，然后他们有一些互动。
So I never.I never read out of books, but I'm going to do it this time. Because I never can remember the nuns' name. So one day this nun called Wu Jin Zhang, came to the sixth patriarch.
那有一天有位比丘尼叫吴静藏，她就来参拜六祖。
So her practice was chanting the Nirvana Sutra.
那她修行的方式就是诵涅槃经。
So she said, well, you know, I've been chanting this for a long time, but there's one little part here that I don't understand.
然后她说，我诵涅槃经诵了很久，但是这边有一段我不太了解。
So if you pay close attention on Friday night when you're chanting the Diamond Sutra, you'll notice that there are sentences in that sutra that you don't understand.
如果你礼拜五有来诵《金刚经》的话，你会发现《金刚经》里面有很多句子，你诵来诵去都不知道他在讲什么。
Right, common experience.
你可以自己来体验。
This nun is not special.
对，这个比丘尼并不是很特别。
So then she said, Could you explain this part to me? She had the sutra with her.
然后她手上有一本《涅槃经》，她就请教六祖说：“你可以不可以帮我解释这一段是什么意思？”
Then she points at this sentence in the sutra. She points to the sentence in the sutra.
然后她就指着《涅槃经》里面的这一段这一句。
Then the sixth patriarch said, Sorry, I'm illiterate. You know, he can't read the sentence.
然后六祖说，哎，很抱歉，我不认识字，我读不懂。
Then he says, read it to me.
然后他说，你念出来吧。
Then she read it.
然后他去，这个比丘尼就把经文念出来。
And then he told her what it meant.
然后六祖就给他开示。
Then she said, well, you're illiterate. How can you know what it means?
然后这个比丘尼就很惊讶，他就问六祖说：“你不认识字，怎么能够理解佛经？”
Then he said something very interesting. He said the meaning is not in the words.
六祖他的回答很有趣，他说：“佛经的那个字理不在文字里面。”
So that happens quite a few times in the sutra. It's one of the kind of like dramatic tension things. It's always the tension between.The person who's read all the sutras and everything and knows everything, but you know, they run into a wall. So that's the purpose of the kongan. The kongan is a kind of question that's very interesting because it's a before thinking question.
那六祖坛经里面很多这种的教导，那它显示了公案是什么？公案就是一个很有趣的问题，这个问题是我们起念前的问题。
So in life, roughly speaking, you'd say there's two kinds of questions that you might be asked.
我们简单的说，我们一生中有两种问题，你会被问到两种问题。
There's thinking questions.
一种是思维的问题。
Right? Like, what's the capital of Canada?
比如说，加拿大的首都是什么？
Ottawa, correct!
Ottawa.
I used to live in
渥大华，对，正确。
So, for some people here, nothing appeared in your mind, right?
那这边可能有一些人听了这个问题之后，脑袋空空，不知道是什么。
So your thinking stopped.
然后你的思维停止了。
Then there's another kind of question that's a before thinking question.
另外一种问题是思维之前或者起念前的问题。
And these questions, you can't look them up on Wikipedia to find the answer.
但是这些问题呢，很抱歉，你没办法从那个维基百科里面找到答案。
So the best example of this is, what are you?
最好的一个例子就是你是什么。
That's the question the Buddha faced.
那这个就是佛陀他面对的问题。
So earlier I said, when Buddha left home, he didn't move to a library to start poring over texts.
刚才我说佛陀他出家之后呢，并没有去图书馆里面找书看。
He went and sat underneath a tree and looked inside.
他只是坐在树下往内心观照。
Because already he knew, kind of like, I don't know, you know the story of Socrates. He's like the most famous Greek philosopher. He was always going around asking people, "What's the meaning of life? What's the meaning of life?"
就好像希腊的哲学家苏格拉底，他常常去问 市场里面的人，你知道人生的意义吗？你知道人生的意义吗？
And of course, if you're honest, you know you can't answer that question, right?
当然，如果你对自己很诚实的话，你知道我没有办法回答这个问题。
But one day, Socrates ran into this very clever person, and this person said, I don't know. But by the way, do you know the meaning of life?
然后有一天，苏格拉底就遇到一个很聪明的人，这个人就回答说，哦，我不知道，但是你知道吗？
Then Socrates says something very different. He says, no, I don't know the meaning of life, but I understand this don't know very well.
苏格拉底的回答就很有意思，他说，我不了解人生的意义是什么，但是我很清楚这个不了解。
So that don't know is actually the basis of Western civilization, except we've kind of forgotten it.
所以这个不知其实是西方文化的很重要的基础，但是大家都忘记了。
Also, when my teacher was a young man and he got this big question, you know, he went to a hermitage and started studying Western philosophy.
那我的老师就禅师的老师呢，崇山禅师，他年轻的时候，他也心里面有一个很大的问题，然后他的做法就是。去找了一个草庵，然后开始研究西方哲学。
So it was right after World War II. The Japanese had just left Korea, but still Korea is a big mess, just like it is today, right? If you read the news this morning, you know Korea is a big mess, right?
那个时候是二次大战之后，日本军已经离开了韩国，但是韩国境内呢却是一团糟，一直到现在还是一样。
So this big mess gave my teacher a big question, you know, like, whoa, what can we do?
这个一团糟的处境呢，就给崇山禅师心里面一个很大的疑问。
So he got this bright idea. He just rent a little hermitage and start reading Western philosophy, and then maybe he could figure it out.
然后他就想了一个很聪明的方法，他想好，他就去租了一个草庵，然后就在里面开始钻研西方哲学。
So one morning he was sitting on the porch of his hermitage and this monk walked by.
那有一天他坐在草庵外面读书的时候，有一位出家人经过。
So this monk looks down and sees this young Korean guy reading Western philosophy.
这个僧人就看到这边有一位很年轻的人在那边读西方哲学。
Then the monk said, what are you doing?
那个僧人就问他，你在做什么？
Then Zen Master Sung Sung said, oh, I'm studying Western philosophy so that I can understand life.
然后他说，我在读西方哲学，让我可以了解人生。
Then the monk just knocked the book out of his hands.
然后呢，僧人就把他的书从他手上甩掉。
And he said, you can't understand life by reading a book.
他说：“你读书是不能够了解人生的。”
But just like this man that Socrates ran into, Zen Master Sung Sung is a strong guy. So he looks at the monk and says, "By the way, do you understand life?"
就像苏格拉底遇到的人一样，那个当时崇山禅师他的内心是很强的，他就反问：“你了解人生吗？”
Then the monk said, "No, I don't understand life."
那僧人说：“我也不了解。”
But I understand that the sky is blue and the trees are green.
但是我了解天空是蓝的，树是绿的。
Then Zen Master Sung Sung, you know, this isn't a usual kind of person.
然后崇山禅师就发现了，哦，这个人不简单。
And then the monk tells him how to do a retreat.
然后这个僧人就教导他怎么样独修。
So that's the idea behind the koan.
这个就是公案背后的含义。
It points directly to your original Buddha nature, your true nature.
它指向你已经拥有的佛性或自信。
What I usually say is it kind of evokes your experience of it.
这公案能够唤醒你的一些经验。
I would say it's evocative. You know, it drags it out of you actually. Usually screaming.
它能够把你从睡梦中拖出来。
So that comes from the originally, as near as you can tell, it come the six patriarchs is acquainted with that kind of technique.
从六祖坛经里面，我们就可以知道六祖对这种方法非常的纯熟。
So that's a before thinking question because the more you think about it, the less you can answer it.
那是一个起念前的问题，因为你越思维，就越不能够获得答案。
So that's the sutra that's the basis of modern Zen teaching, which we use right here every day.
那这本书它的教导就是我们现在禅宗的基础，我们这里每天在运用的方法就是从那里来。
And it's based on the Diamond Sutra.
那这是有从《金刚经》里面来的。
And the Heart Sutra, which we also chant, well, we chant that every day.
也从《心经》里面来，我们每天都会诵《心经》。
So what I recommend is if you want to have some fun, read it.
那我的建议是如果你想要有趣的话，那读一读《六祖坛经》。
But don't look for any explanations.
但是不要从里面去找任何的解释。
But it's a very good story. It's very encouraging.
但是它是一个很好的故事，是一个非常有能够鼓舞众人的故事。
I always say sutras are not for explanation.
我常说，佛经的目的不是要解释任何的东西。
They're for encouragement.
它是为了鼓励你。
So I don't know. Just last night, somebody was saying, "Oh, I just lose all of my enthusiasm for doing this because, of course, it's boring, right?"
啊，昨天晚上小餐的时候，有人说啊，我已经没有什么兴致了，对于这种修行太乏味了。
So one thing you can do, I mean, imagine the Buddha for 6 years doing that practice. How boring was that? So. So one thing you can do is, well, just go back and start reading some sutras like this one. You know, it will pump up your energy again.
所以当你觉得好像修行没有力气的时候呢，有一个方法就是你可以再读一些佛经或者六祖坛经，然后它可能会给你一些推动力。
Okay.
可以吗？
What it means is.
意思就是。
Zen means find your true self and help the world.
禅宗的意思就是找到你的自信，帮助这个世界。
So this is all encouragement for doing that.
这些经典呢，都是用来鼓励你去那样做的。
As is the Buddha's life story.
佛陀他一生的故事也是一样。
They're quite different, but they have the same behind meaning.
佛陀一生的故事跟六祖一生的故事非常的不一样，但是他们背后的含义是一样的。
Wake up to what you really are, and then.Help the world.
证悟你原本的自己，然后帮助这个世界。
So, any questions?
有问题吗？举手。
Yes.
Master, so when an awakened monk, they say the sky is blue, the trees are green, and a normal person say the sky is blue, the trees are green. What's the difference?
Right.
他的问题是一个开悟的高僧，他说天空是蓝的，树是绿的。一个普通人，他也说天空是蓝的，树是绿的，那有什么不同吗？
Very good question.
很好的问题。
So before his enlightenment, the Buddha was attached to name and form.
那在佛陀他开悟之前，他执着名相。
That's why he gets so scared when he sees an old person, a dead person, and a sick person.
所以当他看到老人、病人、死人的时候，他觉得非常的恐慌。
Then he practices, 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 and detaches from name and form.
然后他通过修行之后，就可以不执着名相。
So then, after that, he uses name and form to help the world.
之后呢，他就用名相来帮助这个世界。
So all those sutras, you know, he must have spent half of his life after he got enlightenment talking.From all those sutras that were written down, right?
对，佛陀他后来的说法，后来就被编辑成了很多很多的佛经。他大概讲了很多的东西。
That was to help us.
那是为了帮助我们的。
So before enlightenment, the sky is blue and the trees are green.
在开悟之前，天空是蓝的，树是绿的。
During enlightenment, the sky is blue and the trees are green.
证悟的时候，天空是蓝的，树是绿的。
And after enlightenment, the sky is blue and the trees are green.
开悟之后呢，天空是蓝的，树是绿的。
Okay.
可以吗？
Any other questions?
还有其他问题吗？
Yes.
So you say we must wake up before we can help the world. So we can't help the world
Right.
啊，他的问题是刚才禅师说正得开悟或者觉醒，然后帮助世界。然后如果我们还没有觉醒，就没办法帮助这个世界吗？
Yeah. So any kind of teaching actually is a mistake.
禅师说任何的教导其实都是错误。
So even that, though that's a clever thing to say, you know, find your true self and help the world, it's a mistake.
所以虽然这个这句话很有意思。正得开悟帮助这个世界，但是这句话本身是一个错误。
Because implied in that statement is time, right?
因为
I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do that.
因为这句话它隐含了一个含义，就是有时间顺序，我先做这个，然后再做那个。
So actually, waking up to your true self is waking up just now.
事实上，正得开悟只是当下开悟。
Right, the Diamond Sutra says the past mind can't get enlightenment, future mind obviously isn't going to get enlightenment, and present mind isn't going to get enlightenment either because it just went by.
金刚经里面有说，过去心不可得，未来心不可得，现在心也不可得，因为它已经过去了。
So one way to think about that is enlightenment is helping people just now.
所以一个了解的方法就是开悟的意思就是当下帮助众生。
My teacher, one thing that my teacher said to me when I first started practice really shocked me. He said, 80% of human beings' thinking is about two things that do not exist, the past and the future.
那我刚刚学习的时候，我的老师跟我说了让我非常惊讶的一句话，他说人类80%的时间都在想两种不存在的东西，一种是过去，一种是未来。
So that's pretty shocking. The past does not exist, right? And the future also does not exist, except in science fiction movies or books or something.
过去不存在，未来也不存在，这是让人非常惊讶的。
So you can't give me even 1 second. I wish you could. If you could, we can make a lot of money. If you give me 1 second of the past, you can't.
你甚至不能够把一秒钟的过去拿出来。
I mean, later you can watch that video and you can see what happened in the past, but that isn't the past. That's a video of the past.
那等一下，你们如果有兴趣，可以看一看那个录影。那录影录的并不是过去，它只是过去的影像。
So he said we spend 80% of our time and our energy thinking about two things that don't even exist. Imagine that.
那他说我们。一生花80%的时间在想两种不存在的东西。
So as the sixth patriarch explains in here, actually meditation means keeping a just now mind.
六祖他在《六祖坛经》也有解释说，修行其实就是保持一个当下的心。
So if you always keep a just now mind, that means you wake up moment to moment to moment to moment. We call that enlightenment, but it's just a name.
所以如果你时时刻刻保持当下的心，一刻一刻一刻一刻，那我们称它为开悟，它只是一个名称。
Okay, so that's why I'd say, well, helping people is enlightenment. You don't have to wait. Do it now, because there is only now.
所以帮助众生就是开悟，你不需要等到所谓开悟之后，当下就是了。
I hate to tell you, this is it.
那我要告诉你的是，其实也只有那样而已，没有其他的任何东西。
But we're always talking, we're always thinking, we're always plotting. I mean, you have to think about the future, right? You won't be able to get home tonight. But don't attach to it.
但是我们花很多的时间在思维、在计划、在想东西。当然，你需要思考。比如说，如果你没有思考的话，你等一下可能回不了家。所以重要的是不要执着你的思维。
And actually, that's thinking about the future just now.
其实我们刚才就在思维未来。
Don't check your mind.
但是不要去审查你的心。
Just let your mind be.
只是让它很随意。
Any other questions?
还有其他问题？
Yeah. father? Right.
他的问题是在观禅里我们教导很清楚我们正确的处境关系和运作，那在我日常生活里面呢，我是一个儿子，我又是丈夫，我又是跟工作的伙伴，有很多，我有很多的角色要扮演，那很多时候这个那么多的角色，那么多责任，让我觉得非常的沉重，很难去应付，请问禅师我应该要怎么样去面对。
So Zen means follow your situation, like you said.
那禅的意思就像你刚才说的，就是跟着你的处境。
So if you're sitting on the toilet and you're acting like you're driving the car, what happens?
所以，譬如说，如果你坐在厕所的那个马桶上面，然后你想象你自己在开车，那会是怎么样的
？Or if you're in the shower.And you're trying to eat, you'll probably have a problem.
或者你在洗澡，然后洗澡的时候你要吃东西，那会有问题。
So if you're not attached to the past and you're not attached to the future, then all these situations appear moment to moment in your life, right?
所以如果你不执着过去，也不执着未来的话，这些处境时时刻刻在你的人生中出现。
So now it's time to kiss my wife.
所以现在是亲吻我的太太的时间。
Now it's time to tap my MRT card on the card reader so I can get on the train. Tink.
那现在我要上那个地铁，然后我就把我的卡在那边刷一下。叮。
Right, but if I kiss it, it's not going to work.
但是如果你去亲那个机器的话，大概没有效果。
So your life is just moment, 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 moment.If your mind is clear, you can become one with this moment.
所以你的生命中只是一刻，每一刻，一刻，一刻，一刻，一个刹那，一个刹那。那如果你的心很清明的话，你可以跟这个处境、这个刹那合一。
So the problem human beings have is they can think about the past and the future.
但是人的问题是，我们会思维过去跟未来。
So you think last week at work I really screwed up and.Let's say it's Wednesday, and now Thursday we're going to have that meeting. And God, what if I screw up again? Blah blah blah, blah, blah right?
比如说，你可能会想，哇，上个礼拜在开会的时候，我犯了一个错误。今天是礼拜三，明天礼拜四要开会了。如果我再犯错误的话，那就很惨。
So your mind is always doing that kind of stuff.、Right?
你的心一直会做这样的事情。
Yeah. So the trick is not to attach to that thinking, because your mind will naturally do it.
那重点就是你不要去执着这个思维，因为你的心自然而然会这样子去做。
That is just,
那你只是。
In Zen we say, three steps live, five steps die.
在禅宗我们说三步生，五步死。
So what that means is, your life will just be boom, 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 boom.
所以意思就是你的生命就是嘣嘣嘣嘣。
So just do it.
所以只是去做。
And then, that kind of cloud will lift from your, you know, worrying. Did worry ever work? Did you ever notice that worry worked?
然后如果你能够很清明的话，你这个焦虑的这个云雾就会散开。你们有没有发现到，如果你很焦虑的话？会不会有效？有用吗
？I used to be a musician. I know that worry never helped.
那我从前是音乐家，我发现到呢，焦虑一点作用都没有。
It gives you a headache and a stomach ache, but it doesn't help you any.
它会让你头痛跟肚子痛，但是不能够帮助你。
In fact, that's a lot of this 80% of your mind thinking about something that doesn't even exist, right?
就是刚才说的，我们的心80%的时候在想着一些不存在的东西。
You experience it all the time if you take a test in school. You know, like tomorrow I have to take the test. You know.
那如果我们是参加学校考试，我们可能要记得一些东西，然后要想起来要怎么样回答。
So what that means is, always follow your situation. So kiss your wife time, tap into the MRT time, go to the meeting time, eat dinner time, take a shower time, watch TV time, go to bed time. Just do it. Boom, 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 boom. That's our life, actually.
所以意思就是时时刻刻只是跟随着你的处境去做，请你的太太的时间，或者搭地铁的时间，或者洗澡的时间，开会的时间等等，只是只是去做，时时刻刻只是去做。
So the Nike shoe ad says just do it.
那 Nike 的那个广告说 just do it.
So when you just do something, there's no inside and no outside, no subject and no object.
当你只是去做的时候，没有主体，没有客体，没有里面外面。
There's no win and no lose.
没有赢，没有输。
In Chinese, just do it is called 无为。
那中文呢？只是去做有一个名称叫无为。
So that means no attachment to the result.
意思是不执着它的结果。
Then that's you.
那就是你。
There actually is no inside and outside. That's made by your thinking.
事实上并没有里面跟外面，那是我们的思维制造出来的。
Actually, there is just do it, but then on top of it, we put this big, thick layer of thinking, and then we get a big headache, an existential headache.
事实上，我们也就是只是去做，但是我们的思维会在它的上面层层叠叠的加了很多东西，然后呢，我们就开始头痛。
Lately, I've been thinking, oh, what's going to happen when I get old? You know, what am I going to do?
你可能会想啊，我老了怎么办
？No result.
没有问，没有这样子想是没有结果的。
Any other questions?
还有其他问题吗
？Well, that's enough.
够了。
Very important is every day do a little bit of practicing.
更重要的是每天花一点时间来用功。
And if you like, read this. It's one of the most interesting sutras to read. At least it's not boring.
那如果你对六祖坛经有兴趣的话，这个是一个蛮有趣的经典，因为它很多故事都很有趣。
And it's free.
而且是免费的。
So thank you for listening.
谢谢大家听讲。大家起立 ，please rise.